If we didn't know that this was all the same variety, there is no way that I would have tasted these three wines and gone, oh, these are, like, I would have guessed all over the shop with them, I think.
Yeah, that's my thing.
That was, that third one really threw me a little bit.
It's not, yeah, third one's weird. That's one of the weirdest ones we've had on the show.
So good though.
Hey guys, welcome back to another week of Blind Wine Tastings here on the Wine for the People YouTube channel. Big thank you, as always, to Different Drop, our local booze gurus, supplying us with all of these excellent wines. They've got a really cool thing. They've set up a little collection page for us on their website. So if you want to try to buy any of these wines for yourself, head to the Different Drop website, go to the Wine for the People section. I'm not going to lie, I'm pushing you there because it also gives a little bit of a kickback to the channel. So it does support the channel if you use the link in the Different Drop page. So please head over there and do that. Also, if you want to support the channel and you don't want to spend any money, just like, subscribe, comment, share, all of that stuff that every YouTuber has ever asked you to do. We're not doing it because we like doing it. We do it because it's the only thing that matters on this platform, apparently. And finally, the bracket this week. So this week we are trying to guess a variety of wine, and looking at the three wines in front of me, I'm terrified because they're slightly different colors, and what does that mean? But without further ado, let's get into this week's episode.
Wine number one, and it looks like, honestly, it looks like tarval. This is almost like, is it light rosé, a heavy rosé, or light red?
The color variation in these three wines, looking at them from afar, we've got this sort of light, sort of cherry juice thing. We've then got a dark red, and then we've got something that looks almost like a fortified wine, like it's brown red. So
beautiful, lighter style red, but still got that, still really nice and earthy, like nice kind of savory, dried fruit, like earthiness, pale, like kind of this like wild strawberry, cranberry thing.
Interesting. Very, I have an inkling already of how this wine has been made, but I'm gonna leave it till the very end because perhaps I could be wrong. All right, so wine number one, very light, very fresh, very elegant, but it has a sapid savoriness, a sinewy tannin that is just sublime.
And just a little bit smoky in the nose as well. Interesting. I think this is gonna be one of the wines that I'm like, it's cool, it's interesting, but it's not offensive. It's just not something that I'm captivated by.
That's awesome. That's really beautiful. I love that. I'm on 12 on that one. That I could drink that heaps because it's just like, it's so bright and pretty, it's perfumed. The acidity is nice and refreshing. It's got this nice kind of savory interest, but that like, that lovely kind of strawberry, currant-y, beautiful freshness is really, really appealing.
I would comfortably pay 50 bucks a bottle for this, and I would comfortably buy 12. I think it is almost as if Tarval and Barolo had a love child, which sounds freaking awesome to me. Wine number two.
Cool. Wine number two. This is the most normal looking of them in the sense that it just looks like red wine. The others sort of have these like little brown tinges going on through it. I wonder if part of this is going to be that one of them is significantly older.
And that leathery thing is still here again. So I'm still going to hold, but Nebbiolo was really my first like key gut instinct here. But this looks beautiful again, like good pouch tobacco.
It's like smelling chocolate. Honestly, it's like smelling dark chocolate, strawberry cake. That kind of gets me into this like ripe Cabernet sort of zone.
It's up and then it's sort of just, and that's good because I often whinge about wines that are up and then they go, fuck you. And I don't like that. This one just goes like, hey, nice to see you. Got some fruit in me. And then you can just chill out and talk to your friends.
Tannins aren't super integrated here, but the acidity is nice and refreshing. It's not like really chlorine tannin, which I expect them from the variety.
Great, dense, pixelated tannin. Amazing structure. What a cracking wine. I would spend a decent amount for this. I'd spend, I think this is gonna be expensive. I'd spend 60 bucks and I'd buy 12. What a fantastic wine. The nose is fantastic. We're talking like ripe Cabernet. That's in my head where I'm at.
I like it. I like it a fair bit. Six bottles, 48 bucks. I reckon that's a little bit more expensive.
And number three, look at the color of this. Amazing style, like Rosato, looks like a rosé, so indicating from variety, I reckon this is that kind of Rosato style.
What I'm smelling is a little bit of aldehyde, which is like developed oxidative handling of developed oxidation of the wine. It's not looking, I'd actually almost sting this as a fault. I wouldn't necessarily say that this is how it should be looking, but it could come from a very specific winemaker and a very specific style.
That's really interesting. Is this, so this smells like a fortified wine and then drinks like a rosé. What's that all about? How have you done that?
There's like a richness and a bulbous sweetness to this. I don't think it's got residual sugar, or maybe it might. And if it might, it might just like a little bit. I'm not the biggest fan of the wine. I'm not too sure what it is and what it's trying to be. That nose, knowing the technicality of how it arrived into the wine, potentially this winemaker's aged it under floor for a little while, or perhaps it's just been ullaged, like it's just had enough air to affect it oxidatively. I personally wouldn't spend more than $20 a bottle for it, sorry. And I'd buy one bottle, and that's sort of being generous.
Right, okay, let's just circle back, reevaluate. So this is all the same variety. One of them's been handled really lightly, one of them's been handled a little bit more heavily, and one of them's been handled by aliens, because this is one of the most bizarre wines that I've ever come across. Like, the color on it is anywhere between a rosé and a port. It's so light that it's more rosé than port, but it's got the brown of port, it smells like port, and it tastes like rosé.
And this is really lovely kind of just intensity of red fruits. It's a definite 12 from me. I hope this is about $40, and this is absolutely my wine of the lineup. Yeah, Nebbiolo three ways. Alpine, Lange, and Rosé, I hope. Well, let's get the boys in.
Cool, fellas, another lineup.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think of this?
Erratic. Loved it.
Erratic. If we didn't know that this was all the same variety, there is no way that I would have tasted these three wines and gone, oh, these are, like, I would have guessed all over the shop with them, I think.
I was a bit all over the shop. I've got a bit of a stab at it, but I don't know, it seems more sure.
I don't think I would have ever guessed the third one as the first two, but I could have guessed the first two as the same variety.
Yeah.
That's my thinking.
That third one really threw me a little bit.
It's not, yeah, third one's weird. That's one of the weirdest ones we've had on the show.
So good though.
Yeah, it's my favorite too.
It's so good.
What variety did you guys have a stab at?
I went swings and roundabouts and then came back to a stab at Nebbiolo.
I did the exact same thing.
I went Cabernet Franc.
Well, knowing this show, you're probably right.
You definitely could be. You definitely bloody could
and
be.
And it's entirely because that kind of looks like the rosé that we serve down at Pirate Life. Anyway, we'll find out what's going on. You've both gone Nebbiolo, I've gone Cab Franc. Lockie, what variety was it?
That was my first call.
All right, wine number one, what'd you guys think?
Great. Cracking. Absolutely cracking. I was 12 on it. I was willing to spend a decent amount. I had in my head like a really interesting take at like a Lange Nebbiolo style thing. Maybe even done by a New World, but knowing that it's Sangiovese now, still I would buy 12 and I'd spend $50 for it.
This was my least favorite of the three. I got increasingly more into these wines as it went along, but now drinking it, it's got like some nice like tomato-y thing going
into it. Yeah, 100%. 100%.
Yeah, big fan, massive fan.
I had 3 for $40. You guys both had dozens. What price point were you at?
60.
50.
Oof. All right. How much was it?
$45 for that. That's not bad.
Pretty much an average between all three of us, I reckon, there.
Yeah.
Yeah,
pretty good.
You're lucky someone went low.
Alrighty.
Cool.
What was it, though?
What was the wine?
I mean, Sangio, but where from?
Maybe.
Cameron Sangiovese. Ravensworth.
Yeah, we've seen some amazing shit from Ravensworth before. Cracking wines.
Excellent producer.
And what an awesome spot. Like, we know Canberra as well as like Adelaide Hills is what we know, like the back of our hand.
Mm-hmm.
But Canberra's a homoclime of Adelaide Hills, so whatever grows well there grows well here.
Yep.
And if it produces wines like that, stunning.
I quickly popped into Canberra in February, just before vintage, popped into Clonakilla and had a bunch of the wines. And Brian Martin, who's the winemaker of Ravensworth, cut his teeth at Clonakilla, one of the most iconic wineries in Australia. But yeah, I mean, lovely, cool climate, really kind of inland, but how good's that for Canberra and Sangiovese? Number two.
Well, number two. Well, I mean, now I don't think it's Cab Franc anymore, but...
It could have Cab Franc in it. Yeah. It might not be a 100p... Sangiovese.
Oh, yes. Super Tuscan.
I really love this. I was all about this. This is my favorite lineup.
This is my middle of the lineup. I forgot to write any notes about them on here. I just sort of wrote down what I thought of them and how much they cost.
Yeah, because I was just in that Nebbiolo zone. And I was like, where's the tannin, where's the acid, all that kind of thing. But I mean, it is a gorgeous wine.
It is a cool wine.
Yeah. Absolute plate of fava beans for this one.
I wanted 6 for $48.
6 for $35 for me.
12 for $60.
Oh! We're making this.
That is amazing.
Is it Aussie?
That is amazing. What is that?
Babo!
Hey!
So really good value.
Amazing value.
Really good value.
Justin Bubb is the winemaker for this, and he's been doing Babo, which is the Babo is actually the Italian version of Brix or Bome. They'll actually measure sugar levels in Babo. Bit of a fun name for it, and slightly distinct and different. But yeah, Chianti, the classic Sangiovese, right? Like the one that really, I guess, put it on the map, the appellation. Fucking yummy.
Yeah, that is really yummy.
Good.
That's cool.
Value,
and man. Really good value, good yeah. Like, value. That's a much more tantalizing option at, what, 31, did you say?
Mm-hmm.
Than it is at 50.
50, 60. Yeah. Yeah. I think that's great.
It's really cool. And then, what the hell?
Sangiovese Rosato. fucking excellent wine. This is so tasty.
Dude, this smells unbelievable.
It
smells.
I fucking
hate it. Oh my God, really?
God.
I was like, I'm not sure how I was looking. I was the first to taste through the wines. I can still smell it. Nah,
smell what?
Aldehyde.
Okay. Yeah, I get you.
This is me being a stickler for technicality.
Yeah.
And I can't get around it because I unfortunately just don't like it.
Yeah, aldehyde's one of those ones when I see it in wine, I'm like, oh, it's fine. As long as it's not the only thing I smell, it's fine.
Yeah.
That smells like caramelized sugar to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, just the caramelized part of it's probably a bit too caramelized. Like bruised apple.
I 100% understand. Yeah. Like when I, bruised apple, really good shout. When I picked this up, I was like, oh, it's a fortified version of whatever we're drinking.
Yeah.
And then I tasted it, I'm like, how does this rosé smell fortified?
This is a classic example, and not necessarily in the case of Noah, because you know Noah likes this wine, he likes this wine, but if you don't know about aldehyde, it can actually make your life better by just like ignorance is bliss.
100%.
I can't get around that though, and I'm sure it's a fantastic wine, I wouldn't be able
to. You're the bartender rocking up to watch someone making a cocktail, and you're like, that's a very slow shake you're doing, this is going to be under-diluted.
It's unfortunately.
Is it?
My thing with this is that like if that aldehyde character was in that, I'd fucking hate it.
Mm-hmm.
But when it's in this style, I'm like, I really don't care because when I drink it, it makes me happy.
I agree.
That's why I got our bottle for $20.
Jesus.
12 for 40.
12 for 30. 20, 30, 40.
Hey, value.
Whoa, that's cool.
Francesca
Rosato di Sangiovese Trebbiano.
From the Barossa.
Sick!
I really like that.
That's and Torzi Matthews, produced by Torzi Matthews, amazing winemaker. Haven't seen his wines in a while.
I haven't seen his wines in a while either.
I wanna, when we finish up the show, if we're not gonna drink the rest of that and we get rid of it, I wanna use that bottle at home to keep olive oil in. I think that's really cool. Like that little, it looks like a bloody bottle of cologne or something.
You know what I reckon we should do is we should take that up to the bar and set it up to the carbo rig, make it fizzy.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
That's cool. Wine of the lineup. That's really challenging.
I'll concede to you guys. Hey, you know,
No. I think wine number two.
Wine number two, I think, is fair enough. I'm happy with either two or one. I think they're both excellent.
I wasn't expecting that to play out the way it is, but I'm going to go with number two.
But if you, if we like something and you hate it, I think it's better for the audience if we pick the thing that, like, group consensus wise everyone enjoyed.
What does the audience think? I want to know in comments, is it better to go with the numbers or is it better to be democratic?
No, but then,
or should we just fight to the death?
Yeah, but then otherwise the other week I'm gonna be like, that dusty Moscato has to be wine of the lineup.
Yeah,
I'm not
exactly.
Leaving this room without my 5.5% Cotties.
This is why we have three different individual people with different backgrounds to taste the wines. We're here for democracy.
Democracy manifest
in the Chianti.
Wine number two, yeah.
Value, quality, consistency, everything it ticks.
Yeah.
Amazing.
But that slaps.
Yeah, we're gonna drink that, that's the best one.
All right, guys, thanks for joining us for another week. We'll catch you on the flip.